The United States has been in Afghanistan since 2001, been in Iraq since March of 2003. Secretary of Defense Robert Gates, very recently, as all of you know, has decided to shift portions of the defense budget to accommodate a more flexible, lethal insurgency type of battle. The question is now before the Congress and before the administration, how do we deal with the ongoing conflicts in Iraq and in Afghanistan? How do we declare stability in both those countries and yet have value to the lives that were lost in the years of ongoing military conflict? This next panel will examine that issue. And I'm pleased to introduce Professor Bobby Chesney. Your program has Professor Chesney at Wake Forest University. We'd like to congratulate Professor Chesney. He has recently accepted a permanent appointment on the Faculty of Law at the University of Texas School of Law. So Bobby, over to you.
Thank you very much, Scott. I'm very pleased to be able to bring to you a distinguished panel of experts to talk about what is, I think, the most pressing possible topic. The formal title of the panel, Strategic Change in Afghanistan and Iraq, Debating the Policy, it's probably fair to say that we cannot any longer pretend that we can have conversations about Afghanistan in particular without also having a conversation about Pakistan. So I will take the liberty of amending our charge here to broaden it a bit. To discuss it with us, we have a trio of truly exceptional individuals. I'll begin by introducing to my immediate left, Vikram Singh. Vic, when I invited him to be on the panel, was a fellow at the Center for New American Security. Since that time, he has been brought in to assist in the White House review of Afghanistan and Pakistan strategy, working as an advisor on those issues at the Pentagon for Michel Flournoy as the Undersecretary for Policy. And he has been traveling quite a bit as a result of that. I believe just recently returned from the region where he accompanied the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Admiral Mullen, and Ambassador Holbrook, and hopefully we'll have some interesting perspectives to share from that experience. He'll be speaking, of course, in his own personal capacity, not as a representative of the U.S. government in the Defense Department. To Vikram's left, we have Tony Harriman. Tony is, currently serving as a Managing Director at EM Solutions, previously served as Special Advisor for Policy Implementation and also as a Senior Director for Afghanistan on the National Security Council from 2003 to 2008. And to his left, Steve Tanner. Steve is an author and military historian, and I want to note that the revised edition of his highly regarded Military History of Afghanistan, A Military History from Alexander the Great to the War Against the Taliban, has recently been published in its revised edition, which brings it nicely up to date. So we'll have the perspectives in an unofficial sense of two different administrations, perhaps, and individuals who've had the inside seats at the policy development process in both contexts, as well as historical perspective that I think will nicely round things out. So rather than go on, and we'll turn it over now to Vikram, and we'll go down the line, then we'll have some mutual response from among the discussants before we open it up for Q&A to the audience.
Great. Bobby, thanks very much, and Scott, thank you. I really want to thank all the organizers for putting this event together. I wasn't sure I'd be able to attend once my hat was changed from being a relatively free-wheeling, free-speaking fellow at the Center for New American Security and being an advisor for the Pentagon, but I did get the green light from my boss to come and talk a little bit about the strategy development process that we've gone through over the last 6 or 7 weeks and where we're headed. But nonetheless, I'm going to do that in my own capacity. I'll be expressing my own views. I will not be expressing formal U.S. government policy or formal statements for the Department of Defense today. The new administration came in, and I think as everyone knew off the campaign, with a serious emphasis on figuring out how to get Afghanistan, and more broadly Afghanistan and Pakistan policy right. And I was feeling that after 7 to 8 years, clearly things were not headed in the in the right direction. And I think in the fall we saw a fair degree of hand-wringing about just how bad things were going to get. We still see some of that, that Afghanistan is on the verge of being in defeat, that we really might be losing. I do like to stress to people that the highest levels of violence in Afghanistan, about what we've had over the last year, which have been it's been a consistently a bad trajectory, are still about 1/16 what the worst violence levels were in Iraq before the surge. And that when I look at Afghanistan, when I spend time there, and I did that both last fall in my capacity as a fellow at the Center for New American Security, and then more recently on a couple of trips in the last 6 or 7 weeks, I see a lot of cause for concern, but I certainly don't see hopelessness. We have made significant progress in Afghanistan, and we are facing a very tough fight. Very determined adversaries. They see the progress that's being made in extending governance in Afghanistan, and spreading education, and spreading access to health care. I believe Afghanistan has had the greatest per capita increase in access to education that we've seen probably in history in such a short period of time. And I think a lot of these things are clearly very threatening to the potential for the Taliban and their allies to turn to power, to regain their grip on this territory. And I think that Al-Qaeda and other extremists with more international aims see it as a priority to try to regain that kind of control, the kind of more unchallenged sanctuary they had prior to 9/11. So coming into this strategic review, while there was a lot of worry, there was also, I think, an underlying sense that if we really think through this, we can probably get things on the right track. And so it was gratifying to me to walk in the first day and realize that people were going to go back to first principles. We really asked from the very beginning, why are we here? What are we doing? And this is how I think a lot of people commented extensively on the fact that we got back to sort of a core goal of disrupting, dismantling, and eventually defeating Al-Qaeda and extremists who have international aims. That's what sent us into Afghanistan in the first place. And that's really why we're continuing to make the levels of investments that we're making today. But I think it's important to know that means we have a focused goal. Well, a focused goal is going to also require a comprehensive strategy. And in the process of doing this review, we look very hard at trying to figure out why do we have this challenge emanating from here? Why is it that all the major attacks on the West, certainly from the embassy bombings in Africa to the coal through 9/11, were actually planned from Afghanistan? Al-Qaeda leadership has now moved into Pakistan, and Pakistan is the epicenter of planning for international terrorism in a lot of ways. But this region has been the sort of most fertile ground for these sorts of extremist movements. And it's important to understand why, not just to understand where they are and how to target them, but why. And I think that we really started to delve into a sort of long-term social, political, and economic integration that has affected a significant region of Afghanistan and Pakistan, in particular the Pashtun-dominated areas of southern and eastern Afghanistan and northern and western Pakistan. And I think if you turn to Stephen Tanner, he's written quite a bit about this concept of Pashtun and the fact that there is this area that transcends the border between these two countries that is the locus of the challenge we face. Thinking about that leads us to this idea that that we have to take a regional approach, that you can't separate, as Bobby was saying, Afghanistan from Pakistan. But there's still two countries. And there's going to be different prescriptions for the problem on the two sides of that border. This is one of the many factors that makes dealing with Afghanistan and Pakistan so complicated. For our adversaries, the border is extraordinarily porous. For us, it isn't, and it probably can't be. I think we destabilization of Pakistan is by far the greatest danger in the region. Destabilization of Afghanistan, insofar as it may contribute to the destabilization of Pakistan, is therefore one of our primary worries. And it's going to take a very careful, patient approach to figure out how we can handle one side of the border where we have a lot of ability to have forces, to have large-scale assistance, to really have a lot of tools at our disposal. On the other side, where we're really trying to help our a partner improve their capabilities to deal with very complex problems. So if our strategy is focused on Al-Qaeda and comprehensive, what does that mean? That means that we know what we're trying to get at, and we know that we need a whole range of tools to get there. And the first element is getting resources right. I have a friend and colleague who was a commander in eastern Afghanistan until the middle of last year, who described his area of operations as a ISR, intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance free zone. That is to say, he couldn't easily call up a predator or call up another surveillance platform to see what was going on in his area. That's not a problem that we've had in Iraq. Since the surge, certainly, we really have put resources into Iraq. So for years, I think that those implementing our strategy, military personnel, our civilian personnel, people trying to do assistance, they've been doing so in a resource-constrained way. And one of the key things that came immediately out of this strategy review was the idea that we're going to resource this effort properly. President Obama approved an increase of 17,000 troops right away, and then followed that up with an increase of 4,000 troops that are going to be focused on training. We're actually going to have all our troops now partnering with Afghan forces, because it's really going to be building their capacity and their quality that enables us to eventually hand over responsibility to the Afghans. Those 4,000 traitors are worth focusing on. They are going to fill a requirement that has gone unmet for years. Not something new, but something commanders have been saying they needed to have the teams to train police and train army, train the Afghan army for several years. And so we really are stepping up to meeting the needs of the people that are trying to implement our strategy and our policy in Afghanistan. On the civilian side, the situation is in many ways even more dire. I have military colleagues tell me every day that they need more civilian expertise out in the field in Afghanistan, because they recognize when they're out there that they're not dealing with just a military challenge. They are dealing with this broad social, political, economic dislocation. Areas of Afghanistan in which it may not be about electricity or access to services. It's really about the breakdown of traditional governance structures, of the traditional authorities, and the ability of tribal elders to actually govern their areas. And our guys are getting very good at figuring out how to talk to these people, how to engage with them, how to try to figure out what they need, how to try to convince them that supporting the government and supporting this effort is better for them and their families and their villages in the long run. But there's a lot of civilian skill sets out there that would be the real backbone of a successful effort. Afghanistan is about 80% agricultural and slightly larger than Iraq. Iraq is maybe 20-odd% agricultural in terms of its economy overall. But we probably have two or three times more agriculture officials serving in Iraq than we do in Afghanistan. And it's just another little anecdote to show how we are going to be shifting our effort and getting resources into Afghanistan now, and asking our men and women serving in Afghanistan to start thinking not in a resource-constrained way, but in a way that's going to be supported with necessary resources. So I think it's important to know that when you work in a tough situation for a long time with limited resources, you adapt and you start designing strategies that are based around what you expect you can get. On this recent trip, Admiral Mullen Special Representative Colbrook stressed to our people out there that they should start asking for what they think they need and let Washington decide whether it can be supported or not. Not expecting, not lowballing what they need out there. And I think we are going to be committed to that. Another key element is balance. You know, we spent a lot of time in Afghanistan trying to spread the writ of the central government. Afghanistan is, though, a tribal, very locally based society. For many Afghans, people from the next valley, certainly people from Kabul or from the distant provinces, are as foreign as probably we are. Local governance is really critical. The challenge there is how do you balance supporting local governance structures, even perhaps supporting local security structures like community policing or community security forces, with supporting national government. It's not impossible. We live in a federal system. We balance central and localized authority. We need to pay attention to how you do that right in Afghanistan. And I think we're going to start working through that. We haven't paid enough attention to governance. This also came out in the review. We don't need to fix corruption in Afghanistan. Many countries have fairly high levels of corruption. We've seen a lot of corruption over here lately in our own country. What we do need to do is be on the right side of corruption. Helping Afghans weed out corruption. We need to be, if we are helping Afghanistan put police out in the field, and those police then are imposing, you know, bribes and checkpoints and things like that on the Afghan population, that actually serves to undermine the legitimacy of the government, undermine our whole effort. We need to be paying more attention to that, and we're going to be working on how you improve governance, not just by getting the government out there, but getting the government out there and helping it be held accountable and helping it put in the processes that enable that to happen. We need to think about reconciliation. This tends to be batted about as almost a political goal. Talk to the Taliban, don't talk to the Taliban. The Taliban are not an aggregate. Taliban is now shorthand for a whole number of phenomena. There are multiple groups, and each of these multiple groups with their different aims in Afghanistan and in Pakistan has different structures and has different tiers. And the vast majority of the people that take up arms against us, as they fought war in Iraq, are doing so for pretty basic reasons. It's good money. It's the only alternative in often cases to the subsistence farm for young men in a lot of these areas. That's probably 70-80%, no one can put a precise number on it, of the people we're fighting. We need to flip those foot soldiers. They need to have some better options, whether that's security forces, Afghan national security forces, whether that's community policing, whether that's new jobs that get created by are really getting some economic development in there, whether that's us getting agriculture right so that farms become a viable alternative to things like poppy, or to the narcotics trade, or to picking up a gun over the summer. Mid-level leaders are also often fence sitters who are going to be going whichever way they think the wind will blow. But the enemy is very good at both providing what it thinks is people need, so that's the attraction component, and then intimidating people who don't go along with them. Convincing the people in Afghanistan that we in the government are going to be able to offer them protection and offer them progress is absolutely critical to having people make the right decision, having people decide it's worth throwing in their lot, and therefore the safety of themselves and their family and their village with the government and the coalition. The increase in forces in the South, in particular, will go a long way to addressing the gap between what we want and what the reality is for Afghans in those areas. If the reality is that the government appears now and then I'm at the mercy of extremists, I'm going to either lay low or I'm going to side with the bad guys. I don't want to talk on too long here, but I think this brings us to the issue of implementation, which is where I think where we all are now, and where I think all the eyes of the world are sort of on the administration as we look at implementation. You know, we didn't have a properly resourced civil military plan sitting on the shelf. Lots of great plans and lots of great effort by our commanders in the field and by the people people out there that have been trying to work by our NATO allies. Everyone's been really trying to get things right in Afghanistan, but they weren't living under this level of commitment and this promise of resources. And they need to redesign their plans for this new reality, for a strategic vision for Afghanistan and Pakistan that includes getting what they need. And there's a lot of complicated trade-offs that happen. If we're going to put a lot more civilians into the effort, they're going to need security. If we trade off some security tasks to provide security to civilians, as the elections come upon us and for the first big governance test in Afghanistan, do we divert some security resources to provide support for candidates during the campaign, to provide support for the Afghan National Security Forces in securing election sites and things like that? These sorts of decisions are complex, and they require they need time to get right. So I think we're in a period of adjustment, but we're under obviously pressure, because this is not, it's not as if we're trying to plan towards an initial effort. We're redesigning and trying to improve this aircraft mid-flight, and I think it really does require the support of our public, the support of the people in Afghanistan, the people in Pakistan, to focus on this common threat and to take advantage of this moment where we've tried to think through sort of really what is needed to get things done. You know, how do you fight corruption in such a poor country? How do you enable civilians to do what they need to do if you want them out at the district level, but the district level, you know, districts of Afghanistan might be highly insecure, particularly in the south and the east. How do you balance local and central control? I think those are things we're gonna be working on. And some of you might have seen Dexter Pilkins did a good piece recently on an effort called the Afghan Public Protection Force. This is one of those challenges. Pilot programs that build local security to get that would supplement the ANP, Afghan National Police, and the Afghan Army. The idea is to get people from the villages to protect their own villages. The challenge is getting particularly the Pashtuns in the south and the areas we've been trying to push this out to do that in the face of intimidation by the Taliban, who are slipping letters under their doors, and anybody who supports this effort is going to be killed. Exactly retribution on people for participating. These are hard things to do, but they're absolutely vital. And at the end of the day, we all know, when we get back to that core goal, there are groups that are planning serious attacks, not just on us, but on Pakistan, on Afghanistan, on India, on Europe, on the nations of Southeast Asia. They're here. This is the world's challenge. And we are, you know, I think in a good position to try to redouble our efforts, to try to get a lot of support on board from the international community. I think having a special envoy that is going to be out there every day has already changed the dynamic. You see the world coming together. You see others being brought in and thinking about this actively that haven't before. And I think we're going to get help from all quarters, and it's just up to us to take advantage of it.
Thanks, Vic. Tim, it's all yours.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and I'm glad you're here.
Thanks.
So, I'll begin. Well, one evening around 6:30, the Watergate Hotel here salon called my line at the National Security Council to report that the Karzai family had a new baby boy. Everybody at the salon was excited. The intelligence community reported the birth about 10 o'clock the following day. Regarding whether or not the arrival of a Karzai baby had elevated general levels of excitement within the intelligence community, the report didn't say. That the hotel hair salon report reached the White House first should cause you no surprise. And after all, the Watergate hair salon operatives focused their every attention on HVB1. High value baby one. By contrast, HVT1, high value target one, rivets agency attention. As a nation, we seek to prevent attacks by terrorist networks and have invested in organizations like the Counterterrorism Center to achieve that objective. This imperative to prevent, urgent, working little tolerance for risk and for playing the long game, frames intelligence collection priorities and more besides. That counterterrorism must prevent attacks above all else influences perceptions of information value. Geolocation reporting enjoys high regard, especially precise reports. For example, the 10-digit military map grid reference that locates a target within a meter. Since high-value targets move often, counterterrorists concentrate on the short term. Although some might cite my appearance to criticize me for arguing from limited data, let me assert that hair salons value a different kind of information. Assuming that the Watergate Hotel hair salon is typical, hair salons value the anthropological. Who is kin to who? Who knows who? Who owes who? Who has offended who? How people frame their hopes and their dreams, what they hold dear, and how they feel. The kind of information that can be reused again and again over the long haul. Information about how a person lives, rather than the 10 digits that might suggest a very good time and place for him to die. Given their proclivities regarding information, hairstylists would make very good counterinsurgents. We invaded Afghanistan as counterterrorists. We wanted the man who attacked us, and we invaded Afghanistan to deny him refuge. The hunt for HVT-1 left United States forces opposite Tora Bora in Afghanistan's east, where they stayed, yes, to protect Kabul, but in a position to enable counterterrorism activities. Our eastern tilt did not change as NATO ISAF expanded, even though we understood that the southern city of Kandahar loomed vitally large in Afghan notions of legitimate governance, and that the south was under increasing threat. Our tilt to the east extended beyond the security range. 1,000 kilometers of secondary roads that Ambassador Khalilzad called for in 2004 were built and now exist in the east. The development funding, commanders' emergency response funds, and we provide military commanders to support counterinsurgency operations went east, where the forces were. The matter is of no small significance. General McKiernan recently remarked to the BBC that we are, quote, not winning in the south and parts of the east. That we are winning in parts of the east reflect the impact that 1,000 kilometers of completed road had on effective governance by 2006. That we are also winning in parts of the east reflects the impact of military development funding available to the American forces positioned there. In 2000 in East, funds provided to the Regional Command East made it the equivalent of the fourth largest donor country in Afghanistan. Our tilt to the East provided the security presence in parts of the East that General McKiernan finds lacking in the South, quote, enough of a persistent security presence in all areas that allow the other lines of operations, better governance, to develop. In the East, we have the resources necessary for effective counterinsurgency operations. In December 2006, we recast our Afghan policy. Counterinsurgency became must-do policy, the equal of our support for building the Afghan nation under the Afghanistan compact. And counterinsurgency joined counterterrorism as a driver of our policy towards Pakistan. You might not have noticed it at the time. It has taken some time to marshal the resources necessary to move beyond a situation that Admiral Mullen summed up this way. In Afghanistan, we do what we can. In Iraq, we do what we must. Only this year will additional combat forces for Afghanistan become available. Many will go south. Only this year will additional troops to mentor and train the police will arrive. Still, the change is taking hold. Confined to Afghan forces through 2007, security force investments across the Durand line include Pakistan's Frontier Corps. And we are learning to play a long game. Strikes against insurgent leaders in Afghanistan have have brought as military commanders balance the quick win that killing an insurgent leader provides against public concern over civilian casualties serious enough to undermine the legitimacy of the Afghan government and the NATO intervention. Today, we're more likely to speak in terms of eliminating ungoverned space in the region of Afghanistan and Pakistan, rather than eliminating terrorist safe haven from which threats to the Afghan state emanate. Why so? Under the pressure of events, international perceptions of the whole Afghan enterprise are changing. I'll use Ayatollah Massoud to explain. In 2004, we were apt to regard Ayatollah Massoud as one of those very troublesome waziris whose Pashtun hospitality enabled what we did not yet call the Afghan insurgency. Taliban and other terrorists threatened stability in Afghanistan. They enjoyed safe haven in Pakistan. The NATO ISAF expanded in 2005 and 2006 by deploying military civil development organizations called provincial reconstruction teams under the rubric comprehensive approach, suggests the mindset at the time. By December 2006, the Canadian version of the comprehensive approach included main battle tanks. In 2006, the British sent combat engineers to join Department of International Development efforts, and they operated together. Over time, the idea of an insurgency in Afghanistan became common currency. Pakistan remained safe haven for many until Ayatollah Massoud decided to become an insurgent. December 14, 2007, he announced the formation of the Taliban movement of Pakistan, the organization which may now govern Pakistan's Swat Valley by agreement with the government of Pakistan. Likely responsible for Benazir Bhutto's murder and with admitted designs on New York, he has become a terrorist too. Massoud, ardently independent wazir, insurgent, domestic terrorist, and international terrorist, has become someone the governments can agree on. Governments of Afghanistan, of Pakistan, and of NATO countries don't much like it. Unfortunately, they don't agree on what to do about it, even though they admit that the solution lies in the political rather than the military realm. Arguments that we can leave Afghanistan to concentrate on Pakistan and somehow contain the Taliban in Afghanistan with a coalition of neighbors seem not to account for the multi-nefarious Ayatollah Massoud and the Swat Valley's newly imposed rule of law. Containment policies conceived around the Durand Line seem an odd approach to contain an insurgency centered in Pashtunistan, one that threatens Islamabad and Kabul, and increasingly exhibits the influence of Al-Qaeda's extremist theology. Rather, we must face the whole of the very difficult Afghan and Pakistan geopolitical terrain. Rather, we must recognize that we have become counter-terrorists and counter-insurgents at the same time. We must continue to do so with increasing coherence. Coherence won't come easy. The national governments involved will be both enabled and bound by a variety of domestic and international authorities. Common design for Massoud does not imply universal agreement that the Haqqani network and Lashkar-e-Talba are unhelpful in every aspect. Even where consensus exists, achieving complementary effects with forces of varying capability for and acceptance of counterinsurgency doctrine will remain difficult. Achieving coherence among the parties lies in the realm of ideas and diplomacy, where Special Representative for Pakistan and Afghanistan Holbrooke must succeed. His efforts will take time, even with the influence large U.S. military and development investments will continue to provide. We may be tempted to achieve that increased coordination that has been a staple of Afghan policy discussions ever since I can remember by taking control. You may remember the Patty Ashdown Afghanistan craze. I wonder what the international community saw in it. Just an accomplished diplomat? Or were we hoping for the high representative authorities peculiar to Bosnia and Herzegovina in the Afghan context? In Bosnia, High Representative Ashdown could compel. More recently, the Washington Post reported that, quote, U.S. and NATO military officials understand that a British general will take over the Southern Command this fall, but they expect that the number two commander U.S. Brigadier General John Nicholson to be the real decision maker. Even if they prove right, rule by deputy has limits. And I don't expect to see an American deputy in a Pakistan Army command anytime soon. We also may be attempted to increase coordination by central direction rather than local control. For example, one might argue that Afghanistan's National Solidarity Program produces the most uncoordinated of results. Indeed, the National Solidarity Program empowers local councils in Afghanistan to undertake, well, just do whatever strikes their very local fancy. One council may decide for a school, another for micropower, another for irrigation. Theoretically, a council could decide, perhaps after watching an old movie, a very old movie, to build a tea house of the August moon. Indeed, these most uncoordinated of local council decisions could produce a country where all the eastern province villages have schools, but no micropower, and all the western province villages have micropower, but no schools. The most unsatisfactory, most uncoordinated result. Thank goodness the bell curve governs local desire. Likely, the ministers of education and power find the National Solidarity Program school and micropower projects more or less evenly distributed, rather than coordinate or even control projects from the center. The National Solidarity Program provides Afghans an element of responsive local governance. Perhaps the best coordination comes from arrangements that empower local people to decide and development officers in the field to support them. Over the time it took us to become counterinsurgents in Afghanistan, we have grown to increasingly value the kind of information of interest in hair salons. We've begun to conceive of the problem we face as a regional insurgency. We have begun to understand that to succeed in counterterrorism, we must succeed as counterinsurgents. As counterterrorists, we must strike when we must, and urgently. However, long-term success lies in enabling the governments of Pakistan and Afghanistan to deliver effective, corruption-free governance at the local level. A governance that will improve the lives and prospects of HVB1 and other high-value babies, boys and girls alike.
Thank you, Tony. Turn it over to Steve.
I too would like to thank you for this opportunity and see this beautiful campus. Regarding Afghanistan, I'm hearing some optimism here, but personally, I see the situation is deteriorating. And in part, we should keep in mind the historical perspective that a number of other countries, empires have invaded us, and none of them have had a direct success. When we went in, it seemed to be a success. And in fact, we had several years of calm when we went in. One thing you have to remember is that Afghanistan, due to the structure of the country, doesn't really have a standing army, and it doesn't protect its borders. Any invader can enter the country, and many have. It's maintaining yourself within the country, which is more difficult. The thing that surprised me about the situation is not the increase of violence in Afghanistan right now, the increase of casualties every year. It's that the true issue has become the stability of Pakistan, a far more important country, strategically essential, a nuclear-armed country. And the question has arisen, is our presence in Afghanistan, which was originally just meant to chase a few terrorists, is our presence there now destabilizing a far larger and more important country? That's the key strategic issue that we have to think of. And that's where the concept that I mentioned in my book, Pashtunistan, comes in. Afghanistan, essentially, several ethnic groups largely based in the north, and then the largest ethnic group, the Pashtuns in the south. Afghanistan is roughly 13 million Pashtuns, but across that invisible border with Pakistan, there are 28 million Pashtuns, connected ethnically, linguistically, culturally. So while we think we're fighting a war in Afghanistan, what's become evident is that we're fighting a larger war against a combined ethnic group, not a country, an ethnic group, of some 40 million people. Key is the government in Kabul has difficulty controlling its own Pashtun population in the south, and as we're seeing, Islamabad can't control their Pashtun population in their west. They call their westernmost province the Northwest Frontier Province. Aside from that, you have something called the tribal territories, which they barely even try to control. The British before them, the British invented the concept because they basically, you know, you people stay in your valleys, just leave us alone. It's just amazing that the very term the Khyber Pass, you know, speaking of old movies, remember the King of the Khyber Rifles with Tiger on Power? The British had bloody battles there. Well, now the United States is having the same problem. We're having our convoys ambushed and blown up. The British in 1842 had the same problem. They had to evacuate Kabul when the Pashtun tribes closed that pass. And I'm not sure if you're familiar with the horrible tragedy that happened. 16,000 British and their Indian allies, and together with families, tried to escape from Kabul back to India, and they were just totally wiped out in the passes to what we call Pakistan today. But, you know, the solutions aren't easy, but the question to be asked is whether a heavy U.S., let's put it this way, a heavy Western Christian military presence in Afghanistan is causing a bigger collapse than we move there to solve. And it was first mentioned to me a couple of years ago, and this was by a head of a top Indian military publisher, that he predicted that in 10 years ago, the country of Pakistan would cease to exist. Now, my colleague and I were shocked to hear that because it hadn't occurred to us. But since then, I'm seeing something similar to that happen. Not just the Pashtun problem, the Baluchistan succession problem, the political corruption difficulties they're having in the government. We may be looking at another military coup there, which is going to just cause unrest all around. But when the new administration considers its policies coming into Afghanistan, the Bush administration emphasized a military solution. Even though they did have the provincial reconstruction teams and they had good advice on that, but it was essentially a military effort. The Obama team seems to be emphasizing social stability and the growth of industry, democracy, freedom for women, this sort of thing, but there's a larger issue, whether the U.S. military presence by itself is a virus within the country, just as it was for other invaders. When the British first went in, they had two periods of utter calm. They thought everything was fine, but just gradually, and this was partly because of Muslim fanaticism and partly because of Afghan nationalism, partly because of the tribal based system, where these people resist the idea of a central government at all. The Pashtuns could be considered the ultimate libertarians in that sense. And that if a government spokesman comes in and says, do you want a well or a road? They'll say, sure. And they'll say, do you want taxation? No. Or, then certain things. Or if he wants to take your women to school, they'll say, no. So they're very independent people. And we just have to watch where we step there. On the subject of women also, I do want to raise something which you hardly ever hear, which is that it goes without saying that, female literacy is a primary goal, for all of us in the West. However, any invader who enters a country and prioritizes rounding up the women and putting them into schools that are foreign to that culture is going to be automatic resistance from the indigenous people. Indigenous male population, put it that way. Now that's unfortunate, but just for the purposes of stability, you have to win in Rome, do as the Romans do, and if we are dealing with a fairly primitive culture with its own cultural mores that have existed over, hundreds and hundreds of years, that needs to be respected. Even if we are more sophisticated, you can't enforce our values on them. And it's not as if we're necessarily dealing from a position of strength there anyway, because they could look at the way we treat our women. That could be one of their biggest fears. All you do is watch a video of girls gone wild and they say, no, our girls are not. To get back to the true reason we're in Afghanistan, it's because of the 9/11 attacks. It was by Al-Qaeda. 19 suicide bombers armed with pocket knives. most of them Saudi Arabian. Another thing we need to question is this idea of spending so much effort and money and lives securing Afghanistan to prevent it from being a staging ground. Now, it doesn't occur to me why a coffee shop in Cairo couldn't be the same kind of staging ground for a coordinated attack using pan-Arab militants as the mountains of Afghanistan. And we've thought this through practically, that what is so essential about this deserted territory, even though Al-Qaeda was using it, because it was there, it was uncontrolled, so they were there at the time, but couldn't they be anywhere else in the world? Couldn't they be meeting in Bonn, Germany, or Glasgow, Scotland, just as easily, particularly with communications and global communications? So you know, that's another thing we have to rethink, whether Afghanistan is so essential to us just to prevent Al-Qaeda from moving back. As it turns out, almost ludicrously, he's just slipped across the Durand line into Pakistan. He's in the northwest frontier province of the tribal territories, according to all evidence. The essential failure of us to get bin Laden right after 9/11 was inexplicable to me at the time. You know, maybe because I live in New York, and the book Bobby mentioned, my office is right next to the Catholic Archdiocese of Nassau County. So you could say that literally the book was written to the sound of church bells going on for the funerals and memorial services that took place over the next 6 months. It was because for a lot of people, they didn't know they were dead at first, so the memorial services going on for month after people finally realized that you know their loved ones were gone, including a lot of firemen and policemen didn't happen to be there, but just rushed to the scene. So then when I saw our military operation that followed, in which the Bush administration seemed to take pride in using proxy forces instead of our own, so that we didn't suffer any casualties, it seemed like a brilliant idea at the time, you know, blood-free warfare, at least on our part. However, it was an utter failure. Osama bin Laden, Zawahiri, many of their main lieutenants just escaped. And we've been in there ever since. If you had told me the day after 9/11 that Osama bin Laden would still be alive in the summer of 2009, I would say you were crazy. But not only that, did our effort with 300 special operations troops plus the Air Force fail, now we've got, with the additions, we'll have over 60,000 US, some 32,000 NATO. We're approaching the same troop levels the Soviets had. And we're also approaching the same situation the Soviets encountered with the resistance growing every year. The Soviets had a couple years of calm when they first moved in. They invaded with ease. You know, the Afghans just stared at them. They just stared up at the tanks, you know, thinking, holy cow. But starting about 84, the Afghan resistance grew, and then it got stronger and stronger. They started getting foreign backers, us particularly. So that's why, you know, I'm not necessarily optimistic that our effort there is on an upward trajectory. Remember the Vietnam War also, where there was never a single time during that conflict when the government said, oh, do a mouse here, we're losing this. It was always optimistic, you know, so we're winning, we're making progress. They'd point to some village that, you know, said, oh, this is doing great, we're starting to educate people, we've got our little farming programs there. And in any case like that, you know, we're going to have some of the population that's with us, which, unfortunately, we end up having an obligation and a loyalty to. And what happened in Vietnam, as you recall, was that we were able to declare peace. We got the Paris Peace Accords. We withdrew. 3 years later, the whole thing collapsed. When I look at Iraq, I wonder if we're in the same situation there. Due to the surge and due to, you know, co-opting the Sunni insurgents, no small part due to the Mahdi army laying down its arms to join the political process. And also, I believe, just general weariness. You know, the ethnic cleansing had gone as far as it could find 60 bodies in the morning, you know, every single day anymore. So now we've got that calm there. We're withdrawing our troops. But strategically, all we've done is give Iran a new and stronger ally in the region. It used to be Iraq was the bulwark against Iran. Now we put a Shiite regime into Iran. So let's wait 3 years from now to see whether the Iraq project worked. Meanwhile, we're busy piling up forces in Afghanistan now. at the expense of the stability of Afghanistan, as I said. Now, the problem with the Afghanistan government, even though I think the Obama administration, the Bush administration, had proper ideas about good governments, good judiciary, building up industry, the economy, the road system, education. Fact is, the only successful industry in the country is opium growing. It accounts for half the GDP, it accounts for 90% of the world's opium. The subject came up at dinner last night, how do you stop the opium trade in Afghanistan? I half joked when he said, bring the Taliban back. They banned opium in 2000, and when they banned it, it worked. Just didn't do it. The next year, when the U.S. invaded, the big surprise to me was when the Taliban fell back from the northern provinces into their Pashtun homeland, and not even the Pashtuns supported them. They needed their opium back. As soon as the Taliban's gone, suddenly opium production shot up again. So that's a difficult problem to uproot. The British don't even want to deal with the eradication problems. That's the only way the villagers can make money, and the British say, leave that for drug enforcement. We got a military problem here. We don't want to increase the number of our enemies. In any case, we're looking at a very bloody summer coming up in 2009. The increase in our forces will naturally mean an increase in our casualties. Doesn't necessarily mean that we'll be losing, the Taliban won't suffer worse. In 2006, they really took us by surprise. Practically main force actions in the south. We didn't expect it. In 2007, the British and Canadians, who we tricked more or less into taking the control of Helmand province, we told them it was going to be a peacekeeping mission, and knowing that the Taliban was raging back. But we have very smart military commanders on the ground, and they know how to preempt offensive, tactical offensives. They see a good reconnaissance, if they see a Taliban build up the troops, we can hit it first. So it's going to be bloody for the Taliban as well as for us. But what does that mean? Except that the level of violence across the border, if the Taliban can't succeed in Afghanistan, they've got another target in Islamabad. So that's another thing you have to be very careful about. The main force of the enemy in this case will go to the path of least resistance. And if that's not the Western coalition, it'll be the government in Pakistan. Meanwhile, the Western coalition will just aggravate the culture, perhaps, the longer it stays there. I did want to make a couple points about, social engineering or creating a stable state, in that past invaders have gone in there with the same good intentions. The British certainly did. The rule of law, their advanced technology with medicine, good governance. And, they didn't want to wreck the country, but, say the medieval invaders did. They wanted to bring order to it. The Afghans didn't accept that as a concept, and partly for religious reasons. They didn't want to be governed by a Christian or a Hindu invader. Soviets went in with the same goal. Even though their system, we have problems with, one of their main goals was to educate women, to create industry, to create an orderly society, same goals with the road network, irrigation, dams, and everything else. But in their case also, good intentions didn't succeed. Afghans are a unique people in a way. Pashtuns are the largest remaining tribal society in the world. A fierce warrior culture, without a doubt, independent from each other. When there's no foreign invader around, they say they went to war with each other. We really have to assess very carefully by looking at historical examples exactly what we're getting into. And more important to me, assess whether Afghanistan is worth it. If we were just a vacate place, would it matter what kind of government they had? Because when there's not a foreign invader trying to oppose a government, believe it or not, they come with one of their own, which is basically a government in Kabul forming his own alliances with the individual tribes and ethnic groups. That's why they have this thing called a loyal jirga, which, is a rough form of democracy of their own, developed over the centuries. We're not familiar with it, but they do have a system of their own, they've left to their own devices. And we should respect that. I'm not sure of the time. There's one more point I wanted to make. This is just a personal thing. I'm very suspicious about our reliance on predator aircraft. Just as a general military history principle, I mean, I'm sure we've all seen the movie Terminator, where the humans are fighting against these robot machines in the air. You know, picture those robot machines with the stars and stripes on them. And, you know, that's a little bit of the chagrin I feel that we've turned to that mode of warfare, that we think, and somebody even said this to me once, this is fantastic, our technology is so good that we can just, like, bomb people, you know, basically in a video game to kill them. So instead of fighting on the battlefield, we're targeting enemy commanders in their homes and killing their families, which in that part of the world, you know, extended families, you know, at no cost to ourselves. And my comment was, I have to remember 911 and those fellows with box cutters, and if we think we're going to get away with this for long without retribution, and maybe it's a karma thing, I just, you know, there's something about this form of warfare. It's like our use of proxy forces. We thought, oh, we were getting away with something here by not using our own troops. Now we're using robots. And this is not to say we should commit our own troops in unnecessary situations, but robot warfare, you know, that's another thing we should think through for quasi-moral reasons, if nothing else. But actually practical reasons, because you don't get away with anything. Nothing's for free. And you know, the United States is vulnerable in so many ways that you know, there's a certain ethos. You know, courage still stands for a lot in war, and it should always, technology should never eliminate that factor. Otherwise, we may be in trouble. Do I have time for one more?
Sure.
As far as solution, I don't want to be gloomy about the thing. I think the whole thing. No, there is a solution to this thing, and Vikram was getting at it, but the Taliban, and Tony also, the Taliban is it's not the old Taliban, it's not Mullah Omar's, you know, group of fanatics who just said, who actually saved the country from anarchy, and finally installed rule of law there, but they were other fanatics. But now the Taliban, which after all just means students or seekers, is basically melded into a pan-Pashtun movement. Everyone's joining it, partly to rally against resistance to the latest invasion. But the Taliban has moderate elements now. There are certain tribes that are semi-Taliban, or they're occasionally Taliban, or others. There's still the hardcore around. We haven't caught Mullah Omar either. But the Taliban can be brought into the political system. In fact, before us, it was in the political system. Back when, before the Soviet invasion, and that was for, you know, for most of the 20th century, the Taliban, who were just the Pashtun fundamentalist Islamists, you know, they were part of the Afghan government. So if we can remove the radical elements, or perhaps even ban the radical elements, no matter how conservative the Pashtuns are, and if, whether they're calling themselves Taliban this year or not, they can be brought into the political system. One thing we have to watch out for is doing a Hamas on them, though. You know, sponsoring free elections in a democratic system, and then when the wrong, you know, people take power, then we, you know, suddenly ostracize them and boycott them and, you know, try to destroy them. You know, we have to learn to accept the country's own political system and their own points of view. And I think violence only aggravates the situation in the long run. We have one remaining military job there, is to wipe out Al-Qaeda. Hopefully we can do that in cooperation with Pakistan, cooperation with the Afghan government. But after that, I think Afghanistan as a project should be left to the NGOs, the European community, and that sort of thing, rather than the US military.
Terrific. Well, first let me invite the panelists to respond to one another if they wish. Vikram, I'll start by inviting you to do that if you have any comments.
Sure. Well, there's a lot in both, so I'll jump in on a couple of things. You know, first, to Stephen, I think that there is sensitivity to the risks of being perceived as occupied. occupier. That doesn't mean we couldn't be. But if anything, what I encounter is disappointment, not resistance among most of the people I talk to. And I just want to stress that I don't just talk to people in the government bubble. I mean, I spent time last fall traveling pretty widely on my own out around Afghanistan. And I met with a lot of people, and there was disappointment that we and the Afghan government had not lived up to sort of high expectations in the post-Taliban, perhaps unrealistic expectations. I mean, it is indeed possible to have an area be fairly secure and have people perceive it as not very secure. It is indeed possible to spread, have electricity and education coming, and raise expectations to such a level that popular perception trends down, even though you can demonstrably show that you have had an impact. That certainly happened to us in Iraq, where you actually are increasing electricity to folks, but they may not necessarily perceive it as meeting their expectations. But I really do have a hard time accepting the notion that we have been seen like the Soviets, or been seen even like the British or others in historical examples. These are fairly sophisticated people, even if they are a different culture or a different, and they look around and they see, okay, you've set up it's an Afghan government. Now that it is an Islamic government. We are not shutting down or secularizing. We may not be doing enough to offer competition. State war acts, and it's hard for us. We're kind of lumbering when it comes to strategic communications, and it's hard for us to really show what we're about. But so thus far, I don't think we have a major worry about being perceived as occupiers, even though that narrative is out there. I really like what Tony was saying about the hair salons and the fact that we're learning about that kind of information. And I think it ties to one of Stephen's criticisms. The fact is, we cannot fight al-Qaeda without addressing the insurgencies that are now, maybe they weren't there before, but that are really present in Afghanistan and in Pakistan. These insurgencies are threatening those two governments, and we basically have a multi-layered conflict. It's resting on a soil of social, economic, political dislocation that can be exploited easily by a range of actors who are seeking anything from local power to the overthrow of their own government to international strikes. And I think that the distinctions are becoming a lot harder to see between al-Qaeda and Tariq-e-Taliban and, Hekmatyar and others. I think that this syndication is actually becoming more and more of a problem. That doesn't mean that we can somehow focus on just one tier. We have to go at this with Afghans and Pakistanis, and there are legions of them that are wanting to help, willing to help, and able to help. And I think we really do have to give this a good shot. I do think Steve makes a good, very good point about the fact that sanctuary is not limited to the backwoods of Afghanistan. We have to be proactive in helping governments govern in a whole range of places. We have to be proactive in helping moderate voices hold sway. We have to be, and in most cases, if we get our act together, that means you don't end up with a situation like you have in Afghanistan. But I do think that abandoning Afghanistan in the 1990s. Led us down a path that we should be very cautious about, repeating with a little wishful thinking thrown in. I think we should take our lessons and do this. And we can do quite a lot.
You know, the incredible thing is that we also more or less abandoned it after 2002 by going over to the Iraq War. And then we turned around and suddenly the Taliban was back.
And I think that we lost a golden government and to the coalition has its roots in that sort of immediate aftermath, post-bond, post, you know, 2005, handing over command, control to NATO, and this and a lot of worrying about whether we have the staying power. You know, I think we have to gauge this fairly well. We're not going to have military involvement in Afghanistan forever. But after our major military involvement winds down, we should have a long-term commitment to continuing the improvement of Afghan and Pakistani societies. I mean, Afghanistan really, I think, Afghans need to know that there is a long-term commitment from us to their welfare, and that the arc may be much shorter for large-scale military intervention. The worry and the thing that leads folks to side take the wrong side from our perspective is if they think we're going to just pull up stakes, then the rational thing to do is to turn to the other side.
Well, the Afghans are counting on us for a long-term commitment. They're barking up the wrong tree. I mean, they're not going to get it from us. They've got a limited amount of time for us to stabilize them. We're not going to stay in there for 10 or 15 years.
Stay in Korea. They're still there.
Well, that's because we're worried about the scale.
So, a couple things. I'd argue that in terms of the single economically viable industry in Afghanistan, I'll refer to the two Newmans. That was the Newman I talked to. And the Newman whose picture appeared in the article that I sent to the Newman I talked to. So the Newman I talked to was the son of the Newman in the article. The Newman in the article was a person who's criticized in 1973 because USAID had built roads in Helmand Province. USAID had put irrigation in Helmand Province, and all of that was making it the opium production viable in Helmand Province and building the, or extended into the day, the infrastructure that allowed opium production in the country. I think that was wrong at the time, but sometime between 1973 and now, Afghanistan had extraordinarily stable fruit and pomegranate and pistachio kind of production, which is there in part and could become again viable. And telecoms have taken off in Afghanistan. Just a great thing. And then there has been some sensitivity to this idea of the Louis Jerga. The interim Louis Jerga was the thing that put together the initial government. The emergency came first, then the interim Voyager to establish an interim government, and the constitutional Voyager to establish the legitimacy of the national government using a mechanism that has always been the legitimizer in Afghanistan. Issues at local levels, and the issue is power at local levels, and the ability, the willingness of the central government, it's got to be the Afghan central government, to live in a system. As it has been for a long, long time. So, one more thing on values. The values that we might hold dear are goals that the society in might well have adopted, as they did sign on to the UN Convention for International Human Rights. But getting there may require pragmatic decisions that enable conditions like predictability in one's life, a secure town, a secure village, access to education. So when you start reading things that come out of other countries, your attitudes start to change over time. And the more things that over time societies change, thank goodness this one has. And so by taking practical steps, one can allow humans to make decisions that humans might make. Because after all, we all have families and children.
Let me jump in with a follow-up question. A moment ago, we were discussing the need for the population to perceive our commitment as a sustained one, whatever that may mean. Is there tension here with our policy towards Iraq? Is there a risk that in drawing down in Iraq that it will buttress the preferred Taliban narrative that the U.S. is eventually going to pull out, especially if they make a play? We will back off there as well. Can make it.
they can make credible claims it will become domestically untenable for us to stay in Afghanistan. Now, how significant a risk is that?
I think there is risk everywhere. Sure. I mean, the drawing down in Iraq, I mean, I don't think things off the mark saying that we, you know, there are significant risks, you know, whether they're unresolved political challenges in Iraq, just, and there are a lot of unresolved issues that we are hoping will get resolved as we pull forces out. We're trying to put in place mechanisms to push for those things. I don't think the Iraq narrative right now, given the dramatic decrease in violence and the sort of perception that there's progress being made, I don't think the dominant narrative is that we were being driven from Iraq, that we got bled out, that we got exhausted. I do think that there is an exhaustion strategy, and that these guys have a very patient, long-term, locally, it's a patient, long-term social strategy, and that we need to have a patient, long-term strategy that can compete with that. There's a lot of critical competitions. This local governance issue, one thing that distinguishes us from other countries that have gone into this region is we have been trying to learn. We have been trying to figure out how to do things. And at the very local level in a society like Afghanistan, certainly in the Pashtun regions of Afghanistan, the question is, are we helping local leaders have control of their local environment, or are we a threat to their control? Where we're helping them, we're helping traditional elders who are leaders who are willing to accept order in Afghanistan, accept the constitution, where we are helping them have control, they're broadly supportive of us. It's highly localized. Where we are seen as a threat to local control, to a threat to their ability to control things in their village, we're going to have more problems. Who is the bigger threat to the traditional authority structures in Afghanistan? I would argue it is generally the extremists who are sort of giving young men weapons and power and steadily so eroding the traditional social structures and replacing them with structures that are useful for their own purposes. We are able, when we actually head down and talk to these people and get to know them and get the hair salon level of intelligence instead of just the surveillance level of intelligence, we are able to figure out, okay, who we can work with and support, and it takes patience. And I don't think we will be militarily in a huge military posture for 15 or 20 years. But I do think that our commitment to Afghanistan, to development assistance, to all these other things, has to be something that we are clear about having as long term, or Afghans have a little reason to continue to, you know, want to work with us.
You know, on the other hand, I think it's become an article of faith among America's enemies that we have limited staying power. Take Vietnam as an example, Lebanon, Somalia, Iraq, which, you know, is similar. And so I think that they do believe that if we can be outlasted, and it's been proven that other people can do it. I was thinking the other day a good analogy for the United States military, which is by far the best in the world, and probably the best in history. It's like a lion. You know, it's designed to be tigers, it's designed to be bears, and you can do that if you ask it. But it can't be the swarm of bees. Bees are around, you know, they can kill a lot of bees, you know, they can fight as hard as it can, but sooner or later the lion's just going to say, get me out of here, I'm going to go away from this hive.
That's an excellent analogy.
Bob Aitken, the speakers question. Use the microphone.
Yes, please. Let's all of us get closer to our mics as we go. Thank you. A question for Tony, and then we'll open it up to everybody. From the perspective of having worked on these policy issues within the last administration, there's recently been the rollout of the Obama administration's new policy. Do you perceive it as being significantly different from what you saw happening from your perch at NSC between, well, the last few years at any rate? And if so, what are the differences?
Well, I would say they're going to resource it, and they're going to treat it holistically. We came to overcome. But the big difference, I think, is that they're going to resource it, and that's huge.
Is it Iraq that's made that possible, that the availability of resources that previously were being consumed by Iraq?
I refer to Admiral Mullen's statement. I mean, I'm not aware of what led up to that.
Well, let's open it up to the floor. Where are the microphones? Okay, great. Why don't we start here in the aisle with this lady, and then that gentleman behind you, go to this side of the room.
Thank you. I'm Beth Berman. I'm just a private citizen, and I live here in Durham. My question is, if we are not perceived as occupiers, then where is the insurgency coming from? What are they insurging against?
Insurgents react against bad governments. The reason that the Taliban took control originally was because to get from one village to another, you had to stop at and pay people at some number of checkpoints, maybe 10 or 15, between the space and the time it took you to drive, unless you lived just off the coast here or stuff, the place. But if you had to drive 10, 15 miles to get here, you would have to come across all of them. And so it's fundamentally the legitimacy of local governments and the fairness with which people perceive the way they're treated. It's very much the legitimacy that's in that book, Failed States, that Claire Lockhart was part of writing. That's what insurgents revolt against. That's what we revolted against years and years ago when there was an insurgency in this country.
I would just add that, first of all, there's a group of people who were driven from power. It's like power back. The question is, how relevant are they to the populations whose support they require in order to achieve those goals? If they're not very relevant to those populations, that is to say, if they can neither offer them something nor coerce them, they become a non-issue. They become people that are not able to affect the progress and welfare of that state. Unfortunately, there has been enough of a gulf between what the government of Afghanistan, what the coalition can deliver in terms of security for the people, in terms of opportunity, in terms of other things, to give those people who would like to return to power enough to work with. And that's the nature of the competition. If we actually address the social, political, and economic issues, along with doing our best militarily to compete militarily, we start to isolate and make those folks more and more irrelevant. And quite frankly, there's a positive cycle that happens in a counterinsurgency, and there's a vicious cycle that happens in a successful insurgency. The vicious cycle is insurgents provide services, coerce, their control spreads, they're able to progress. The positive cycle is government, counterinsurgents are able to provide protection, more people feel comfortable enough to side with the government, they provide more intelligence, insurgents get more and more isolated, and they're actually then easier to target if they aren't, if they don't become irrelevant, they're easier to target. So that competition is what this is about.
Hello, my name is Richard Ellman, and I live in Durham. First question is it administration policy, if in pursuit of a hot target in Pakistan, to send in troops or aircraft? Second part of that is, if it is that in agreement with Pakistan government? Also, why is the United States having difficulty in getting NATO and European countries to send additional troops to Afghanistan when Afghanistan is in their backyard?
I'll speak. So, first of all, I'm not going to speak on specific operations, policies, operational policies. I'm speaking in my own capacity here. Second of all, we cannot succeed in Pakistan without the Pakistani government, the Pakistani military. We have to cooperate. So how we make that cooperation as effective as possible is one of the key challenges for the administration. And people are working on that constantly. And then finally, what was the last part of the question? Sorry. NATO. Look, this is hard. And quite frankly, just as we've gone through an extremely large learning process on the U.S. military. And I would say, and I don't know if Tony would agree with me, that our allies have not gone through that process to the same degree, though there have been a lot of adjustments. But at the end of the day, capabilities, available resources, the doctrine, it's hard. It's politically hard, and it's difficult. So I think the fact that we got another 5,000 troops in the last few weeks committed from NATO, I think that the fact that we're getting more police trainers from countries, the fact that we're getting large contributions to the Afghan National Army Trust Fund and the other trust funds that are there to help Afghanistan are very significant. Again, I'm speaking my personal opinion. I'm in favor of playing to comparative advantage. I don't think that it does us much good to push a partner into an untenable situation to say you should really take the fight to this place when their forces aren't prepared or able or really ready to do that. Maybe they'll develop those capabilities over time, but it is an alliance and it's a collaborative effort. And I think we are getting a lot, and many of our allies have sacrificed very heavily.
I'd argue this: the reason that NATO parliaments or NATO forces may not contribute, it has to do with Congress. Everybody's got one. They have one too. The German parliament has allowed that army to go outside the country with a very troubled history. And so that's extraordinary for them. And they're also changing the way they're building their army in order to allow that to happen in the future. Japan, not part of NATO, but they are also doing the same kinds of things because these countries see the need to engage in these kinds of activities. But they're also dealing with their people, and they all have a vote, and they exercise it through their parliaments.
Ian Bryan from the Air Force's School of Advanced Air and Space Studies. This conference seems to mirror well American national security, the title National Security Under New Administration. It's very focused on Iraq, Afghanistan, the war on terror. And I wonder, from what we learned in Iraq and Afghanistan, do you see the future of American national security strategy are these the types of conflicts that you expect to see in the future? Certainly, we're remaking our national security apparatus to deal with this sort of threat. Is this the future, or have we learned something from these that will cause us to turn away in the future from these sorts of operations?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of people like to say the enemy has a vote, and I think as a dominant military power, we will face asymmetric challenges, predominantly, certainly when it comes to large scale. Engagements. That said, I personally, and I can't stress enough, and I am speaking from personal capacity, I personally am sensitive to the idea that these are not the kinds of efforts you want to be making. I don't want to design, I don't want us to think about Iraq and Afghanistan as models that we like to replicate. I think that they are the key strategic lesson from these sorts of efforts is actually the need to be much better at things like building effective partnerships with other countries around the world, helping countries build effective, responsible militaries and security apparatus that help them control their own territory, working jointly with partners to help bring order and hope and better governance to areas that can easily be a refuge and a breeding ground for extremist threats. And then I don't think you can take your eye off the conventional challenges that are out there. Personally, I think a lot of the challenges we'll face will be new challenges as more and more in cyberspace and in issues of other countries having more capable navies, of other nations having more capable air systems, particularly things like UAVs that are inexpensive that will probably proliferate fairly rapidly. So I don't see it as sort of an either or. I think we have to be prepared for everything. But I do think that we've learned a lot, and we should not lose the lessons of a very hard period for the military.
I think that was sort of an understatement that the Iraq War continuing commitment to Taiwan worries me, that, you know, because China's getting so capable, they're still capable of large conventional war. The other thing is the Israelis hit the Iranian nuclear plants, and that's going to blow up the region. We're going to have a whole other kind of war. It'll be a ground zero war of naval and air, because Iran is also building up their capability in that way. But history is just full of surprises, so it's you guys have to be ready for anything.
I'd say multipolarity is the emerging dynamic that's going to govern security policy in the future. It's going to become increasingly necessary for us to cooperate very broadly in the world on a number of issues, and that requires governed space. And so we'll be fighting conflicts that are associated with governed space and ungoverned space. Because you can hatch a plot in Cairo, but the police will come down the street and be asking when the government agrees.
Yes, sir.
Tom Howe, just a local citizen. What do you expect in Pakistan? You know, we're having difficulty in Afghanistan. Pakistan was a much larger area and much larger number of people and all of that. Are we going to win there? And the other thing you haven't mentioned is, we're talking about Iraq and Afghanistan. What about Iran, which is right in the middle? Could they give us more trouble on either side to keep us running around on that little section of the area?
I think Pakistan is part of the challenges in Pakistan are more difficult to get at for us, given the difference in what we have available. We have a lot of forces in Afghanistan. We have freedom of movement. We have an agreement with the government to continue having international military operations. Gives us a lot more options. It's pretty easy for people to lay out options. I think for Pakistan, it's a lot harder, and it involves a whole range, a whole series of efforts. They range from supporting the sort of relatively new and fairly weak democracy and the civil governance structures of Pakistan. They include helping Pakistan spread governance into regions, parts of its territory that have been historically under or ungoverned. And they extend largely to building up Pakistani capabilities to conduct effective counterinsurgency and other operations. And part of that means Pakistan focusing on threats we see as our common threats more than other threats. But I would say that I think it's more difficult. Iran certainly has caused complications in both Iraq and in Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, at least, there are some areas of strategic convergence with Iran. I think that there's hope that there might be some openings there for slightly more positive, interaction. But that Iran has an incredible amount of influence in the region. It can cause trouble.
Iran dislikes the Taliban immensely, goes by past experience. And during the Taliban's heyday, it wiped out a bunch of Iranian diplomats in the north. And just the fact that they're Sunni extremists, whereas Iran is a Shiite country, Iran has no inclination to help the Taliban. They do have some inclination to make things difficult for us, though. So.
I forget the guy's name, but the U.S. representative in the Bonn talks first put the government together. And the idea of taking somebody into a corner, you know, and talking to them, and our president did that recently, two people into corners and talked to them. It was the Iran guy who did that, according to him. I wasn't there, I don't know. One of the neat things about the ring road in Afghanistan and the whole world is we cooperated on the building. It's a road that kind of goes around a big mountain in the center. It connects Central Asia to the sea. One route's through Pakistan, the other route's through Iran. It's kind of cool that there are two rounds because maybe they'll compete. Maybe that competition will cause countries to change the way they structure the way their trade policies and customs policies are. So you can't look at Iran as a thoroughly troublesome state. It's a complex state. on this one like any other.
Yes, sir.
Michael Cotter, I'm a retired Foreign Service officer, lives in the area. I'm glad multipolarity finally came up, because I don't know that we can discuss U.S. national security in the next decades without recognizing the fact that the world is now multipolar, and Central Asia is a key area. You made it a regional issue, Pakistan and Afghanistan, but the fact of the matter is that you have a region that has four nuclear powers, possibly five, most of whom don't want us there. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization was founded by the Chinese and the Russians specifically to end U.S. presence in Central Asia, military presence. The Indians, the Pakistanis, the Iranians, and the other Central Asians have all signed up in one form or another. There's some thinking that our military presence actually exacerbates the whole situation because it prevents the regional neighbors who actually have much more to gain from this or to lose than does NATO or we won't get engaged as long as we're taking the lead. We pay lip service to having partners, but it's always we having partners. It's not a set of partnerships in which we are one of the players, not the lead player. And somehow I think we have to find a way in this strategy in this area to engage the regional countries to somehow deal with the Pakistan-India conflict, which hasn't been brought up, to really solve this, that I don't think we're going to solve it militarily or politically. I think the regional countries are going to have to play the key role in doing so.
Comments on the comment, just a little bit. I actually think that this the international engagement piece has been perhaps one of the other dramatic departures, a really big push by the new administration. I've been in government before. I was kind of on a lot as a career civil servant in the last administration. I'm doing this now. We're really out there. This strategy review is not a star chamber U.S. strategy review. We talk to all of our partners through the whole process. They came in, they were involved, and I think that the change is noticeable. It's not European partners only, it's not Western nations only. That was partners in the region. And I do think that having Ambassador Holbrooke work this issue, this understanding that's not, my regional, we only touched on Pakistan, which is a clear recognition in the administration. This is a regional and global issue. And that's a primary focus area to try to really engage all actors. I would note that the U.S. actually did send a representative, low level, but did send a representative to the recent Shanghai Cooperation Organization meeting in Moscow that was on Afghanistan. This is a good faith effort.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more with your point about multipolarities. I just wanted to comment, it was really a knock on the door when Kyrgyzstan closed down that airbase, which I think they intended to do. It's not definite yet. After a visit from Vladimir Putin, suddenly our major airbase supplying Afghanistan, that combined with the variable closing down of the Khyber Pass, on every other weekend, it's going to be hard to sustain ourselves. America is a stranger in a strange land there, bringing in our European allies. Unless we get a framework of regional power or countries to support us, we're going to have trouble even maintaining the effort.
I'm Lieutenant Colonel Morris in the North Carolina National Guard, and I also served in 2006 in a rule of law capacity with Combined Forces Command in Afghanistan. I'm interested, and my question sort of arose in my head outside of some of your comments, but it seems now that it's sort of a follow-up to Mr. Tanner's comments earlier, Mr. Singh's comment. Under the Bonn Agreement, Afghan National Development Strategy. In 2006, we were working with the European community intensively, and many of our rule of law, governance, civil affairs type efforts, where we were able to provide security for small, discrete projects, even though we were woefully under-resourced, our efforts often succeeded or didn't succeed because of the European community, because of their restrictions, their limitations, their assistance, or their willingness And given that we were military, we were on the periphery, so I'm mostly talking about European development agencies and USAID and some of our civilian efforts that, you know, and I'm not necessarily talking, so I'm not necessarily addressing military strategy so much as how does the Obama administration hope to have a better working relationship in the, say, the division of effort and work under the Bonn Agreement with Germany and Britain and Italy. Italy, of course, had the rule of law stuff. But I'd like to hear what Mr. Singh has to say about, or Mr. Tanner, about some of those aspects of the effort.
Sure. I think it's hard, again, this kind of, it's hard for civilians to work in insecure environments. And civilian departments and agencies have practices when it comes to working with the military that vary greatly from organization to organization, from country to country. You know, the coalition efforts are a blessing and also a challenge because you have lots of different rules and lots of different expectations. And it certainly hasn't been easy. I really commend you for your service and thank you for trying to get those things done. It's not easy. What we need to do now, and this is as someone who works in the Department of Defense, what you really want all the time is command and control. You want to be able to say, okay, go out and do these things. Well, it doesn't work that way. It's not going to work that way. You need to have coordination, communication, and an effort to allow things like Tony was describing, like National Solidarity Program, that may be disaggregated and seem chaotic from a strict military perspective, but that add up to something greater than the sum of their parts. I think the way to do that, and it's been, the way that's worked effectively in other situations, is when there is some kind of strong coordinating body, understanding that countries are going to do their bilateral aid efforts, countries are going to do their things their way, and private organizations and NGOs, who are a big part of this, are also going to do things their way. Some have operated in Helmand for decades now and continue to operate, even in a very insecure environment. Others will go here, there, and will stick to Mazar-e-Sharif. I think the key, and I think the goal, is to figure out what that body can be that can actually help get our arms around things, not to have command and control, but to help coordination. In my opinion, in a coalition effort like this, it's going to be some kind of partnership between the government, the host government, and the United Nations. And quite frankly, the United Nations mission in Afghanistan has not had really a fraction of the resources, the authorities, all the other stuff it would need to be able to play a really effective role. And I think we're going to, I think that there'll be an effort to see if we can improve, that. But it's a challenge. It's a challenge in any situation. Quite frankly, it's a challenge in peaceful development efforts to actually coordinate the multitude of actors that go in and all want to do good things, but sometimes aren't able to really have an overall strategic effect.
We have just enough time for one last question. Judge Everett?
From Robinson Everett from Duke Law School. I've read articles to the effect that opium is one of the principal products of Afghanistan and that it presents certain special complications. Could you comment on that, whether in our quest to maintain tranquility in that part of the world, whether the opium trade and the consequences of it are significant?
I've been dealing with that for quite a while, and there's a, let's say, it is consequential as it is across our border inside this country, as it generates a large amount of money. And that large amount of money enabled people who would undercut civil governments the wherewithal to do just that. And so that's the problem of drugs. And so you have a power base, a money-generating source that's outside government, controlled by people who are extraordinarily self-interested, and they don't have the common interest of the country at heart. Where the project has been most successful is in places like the center of Nangarhar province, where there has been security, there have been roads, there have been reasonably effective governance structures. And all of those things combine to build conditions where a farmer can get goods to market. And so farmers start to choose different kinds of activities. So, you know, there's not much time, but that's generally the issue with drugs. It's the same issue we struggle with here.
We need to focus on the nexus of the drugs and financing of terrorists and al-Qaeda operations as a first place. And I think it is not easy to do, but it is a major source of revenue for insurgents. So hitting the right people first, being able to interdict supplies, being able to deal with storage facilities and other things that can more focused way on the cash generating part might be a priority, have to be a priority area. We want to try to disrupt the nexus between the drug money and the insurgents.
With that, I think we should give our terrific panelists a round of applause. We'll be hearing from Congressman David Price from his perspective of homeland security threats and what may need to be done about that. That luncheon is set to begin at 12:45, so we've got about 15 minutes. You've probably found the restrooms by now, so I'm not going to point those out to you, but we have about 15 minutes. For those of you joining us at lunch,